What do we end up with? We ended up with what's called deep QA. This is the underlying architecture inside Watson from about 50,000 feet high. And what it shows is that we're analyzing the topic, the category, and the question. We're decomposing it. We're pulling out many different hypotheses or candidates. You get this big fan out, all right, effect, at least from a computational pattern perspective, not necessarily from an implementation perspective. It depends on how you implement. But while you're starting with one question, you're getting multiple interpretations, you're looking at hundreds of sources. You're actually, in the case of question decomposition, you're following two parallel paths through this entire thing. Many possible answers. For each answer, you're getting many different pieces of evidence, passages, documents, RDF triples. And then for each evidence-answer pair, you now have 100 different algorithms looking at different features of this evidence and producing a score. 50% sure this evidence supports this answer. 80% sure. 20% actually refutes it. Negative. You can get a negative score. Now we have to weigh all those scores and ultimately combine them to get a rank list of answers with a confidence value, a probability that the answer is correct. So here we have models that we produce through machine learning. So we run the system on training data. We learn how to weigh all these various algorithms. We produce a model, set of weights, that at runtime gets applied. And then we get our rank list of answers, and we actually get a confidence score that we map to a probability. If that confidence is above a threshold, Watson wants to buzz in and answer the question. In other words, is willing to take the risk given the environment. So what do I mean by given the environment? If it's really well ahead in the game and those, it's winning by a large margin, why take a risk? So it moves its confidence threshold up and says, I'm not going to answer unless I'm 95% sure. If it's well behind and it's thinking about how my career is going down the tubes, it's willing to take a bigger risk, right? And now it's willing to basically buzz in at a lower confidence threshold. So that's how it played the game. But you can imagine that in real life, you have a very similar scenario where under what conditions am I willing to take higher risks or lower risks? And what drives that decision is this confidence value. Now, given that architecture and given this large body of algorithmic techniques, all of them had to ultimately be refined. And the method for combining them had to get better and better. The confidence score had to get more and more accurate as the underlying algorithms, the parsing, the textual entailment, the disambiguation, all these things had to get better and better. And it wasn't always hunky-dory. So I wanted to give you a sense of some of the growing pains. These are actual Watson answers during earlier phases of its development. So the American Dream, decades before Lincoln, Daniel Webster spoke of government made for, made by, and answerable to them. Anybody? The people, right, Watson? No one. So, New York Times headlines, an exclamation point was warranted for the end of this in 1918. Anybody? World War I, Watson? A sentence. An exclamation point ends a sentence. It really doesn't matter what year. That was Watson's. Yeah, the correct answer is World War I. Milestones. In 1994, 25 years after this event, one participant said, for one crowning moment, we were creatures of the cosmic ocean. Moon landing, that's exactly right. Watson, the Big Bang. Not a lot of people around, but you have to understand that, when this happened, we got this answer, the state I was in was I was happy it even answered with an event. So, it's silly. The right answer is Apollo 11 moon landing. The Queen's English. Give a Brit a tinkle when you get into town and you've done this. Call him on the phone, Watson, urinate. But yes, you're right. The right answer is call on the phone. And finally, no good explanation for this one. Very early version of the system, but always gives me a chuckle. Fatherly nicknames. This Frenchman was the father of bacteriology. Anybody? Pasteur, of course. Watson, how tasty was my little Frenchman? So Louis Pasteur was the answer. Evolving the system, getting it to get better and better at the task was not simple. It was a process that actually involved cultural changes within the resource organization, changes in how we worked, how we thought about our work, how we thought about the project, and the incentives we put in place. We moved out of individual offices into one big room. We didn't even allow cubicles. We sat around tables. There was this notion of extreme collaboration. There was also a very key notion was that a researcher didn't come in with an algorithm or a belief that says, you know, I do support vector machines, and I'm here to prove support vector machines are the best things in the world. Nope, that's not what we're doing. Or, you know, I work on parsing, and what I really want to get out of this are three publications this year about how I'm better at the Penn feedback data. Nope, that's not what we're doing. What we're doing is you're developing, you're coming up with hypotheses about what you think is going to make a difference in this task, and you're going to present that hypothesis about how your technology might advance the system performance, and then you're going to implement that and very quickly give us turnaround on how much you've impacted the system performance in combination with everyone else's algorithm. We're not going to publish for 4 years. First, we're going to do something really remarkable, and then maybe somebody will read your publication. So it was a big change in how we approached, you know, the problem. And you know, people ultimately bought into it. And you know, initially, not everyone was completely convinced, but they're open-minded enough to work differently in this different context. And then they saw improvements, dramatic improvements, and dramatic results that they hadn't seen in their own work for 10 years prior, happening in just a year, 18 months, 2 years. So the team was sold within about 18 months of working this way, and things started to move very, very rapidly. Natural language processing, people, information retrieval, KR&R, machine learning, computational linguistics, intelligence, architecture, software engineering, all in one room, all working side by side. Computational linguistic would get stuck, and he'd look, all his face would be all contorted, and he'd be sitting right next to the software engineer who would look at him and say, what's the problem? This is the problem. Oh, here, let me fix that. And it was fixed. Prior to that, you know, 2-3 weeks before a meeting would ever happen for that person to admit that they were having a problem and they needed help. Right, so things move much more rapidly. We did bi-weekly end-to-end integration runs, meaning everybody would work on their workspace trying to prove that their stuff was going to make a difference on the last version of the system. So 2 weeks prior, they checked out the whole thing. They're iterating on their ideas. They're running independent experiments, and they're showing that at least they're doing no harm. Hopefully making things go up. They don't know whether or not someone else producing another algorithm is going to eat their lunch. They won't know that until we do an end-to-end integration. Right? So we didn't imagine that everyone was going to build a consensus on, I'm doing this, how does it integrate with you? So it wasn't this top-down design where we knew how everything was going to integrate with everything else. People were literally looking at their algorithms as independent algorithms that were going to compete for having impact on the end-to-end result. And we did these bi-weekly end-to-end integration runs. They would produce 10 gigabytes of error analysis data, which we'd slice and dice and have to analyze to figure out what actually happened. Now, there was a comment made earlier about testing. So this system was fraught with problems all the time. The only bugs that got resolved were the bugs that caused the system not to produce an answer, or failures that we're able to detect by looking at the actual output it produced. But there were lots of weaknesses in the algorithms that, frankly, went undetected and are still undetected. Ultimately, all we had was it doing well? Was the end-to-end performance good enough? So this is, we did 8,000 documented, over 8,000 documented experiments in 4 years. What I mean documented was that everybody had to update a wiki page and say, here's my hypothesis and here's the experiment I'm doing. Here are my results from the last 2 weeks. Here's the impact that it had, blah, blah, blah. And they would produce a wiki, and then they would actually run the experiment. And all the experiments were logged, and you'd be able to drill in and actually see the results. You'd be able to look at aggregate statistics and graph the stuff. You'd be able to look at all the questions in that particular test set, what you thought the question was asking for, whether the answer it got in top position, whether it was right and wrong, the confidence it produced, whether or not the correct answer was anywhere in the recall. And then you could drill in and say, what would for that question, how many answers did it produce? and let me see those answers ranked by their confidence, and now let me see the features. So now you have 600 features that you're looking at, big row of tables, numbers between zero and one. Can you make any sense out of this? No. What's interesting, however, is that some people thought they could. So they go, oh, I see what's going on there. What? I know you for 25 years. You're not that good. So we had to produce tools that allowed you to quickly visualize the impact features were having and their behavior. So as a feature score went up, was its ability to predict the correct answer going up? Maybe its impact was very, very small, but at least did it have the right direction. Here we have a bimodal feature, not good, right? So, but it suggests maybe you have two features here. Maybe you should split this up. So we were able to quickly look at things like this and then actually start to look at the comparative effect. So here's the question. It's a bit chilly today. Chile shares its longest land border with this country. We have Argentina and Bolivia, hundreds of features. And what we're looking at is the two top answers, Argentina versus Bolivia. And we're looking at how that feature contributed to the right answer and to the wrong answer. So very quickly see, wow, these features are preferring the right answer. These features with the yellow here are preferring the wrong answer. So, and then this is still hard to imagine, right? So many features. So we created semantic classes. This is after the fact. Oh, wait a second. This is fascinating. We've got 20 people doing this. And we turned out we produced a whole bunch of features that have to do with location, geospatial information. A lot of people had similar ideas. And they all did things slightly differently. So let's group that on the geospatial features, passport features, popularity features, source reliability features, classification features. There are other classes. I'm just showing a few of them. And we would do the math to aggregate these things and say, ah, look at that. Here we have a question. You'll find Bethel College and Seminary in this holy Minnesota city. All the features preferred South Bend, Indiana. It's a Minnesota city. All the features preferred South Bend, Indiana because there was a Bethel College and Seminary in both St. Paul, Minnesota and South Bend, Indiana. The only features that preferred St. Paul, Minnesota was the geospatial features, location features. That's good, since St. Paul, Minnesota is in Minnesota. But the weight was very small. So this suggested a problem. It doesn't know what it's doing. We're weighting location information incorrectly in the context of a question like that. So this taught us something. We actually were able to produce what we called evidence profiles. So here's the one for Argentina and Bolivia. Worked out great. Interestingly, Bolivia had a bigger score for popularity because in some of the web content that we were able to suck in, because Watson was ultimately disconnected from the web, but we derived some content from the web. There was a lot of discussion between a border dispute between Bolivia and Chile. And so there was a lot of popularity signal there. But the more precise features overwhelmed the popularity feature, which is good. Here's the South Bend, Indiana one. Again, St. Paul, Minnesota, South Bend, Indiana. Location, not enough weight. We knew, look, negative score for South Bend, Indiana. It's in the wrong place. But we didn't understand in a context like this, location means everything. So we learned how to get better at that. But interestingly, someone looked at this and said, wait a second, we got holy, and holy's in quotes. There's a pun going on here. Independently developed a pun detector based on fairly simple heuristics, plugged it in, trained it, and the pun detector earned the weight and preferred St. Paul over South Bend, Indiana, because St. Paul's obviously holier than South Bend. Of course, what came in second place was Holy Cross, Minnesota, also holier than South Bend.